Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I am glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. My name is Brian Diffie. I am one of the pastors here at First United Methodist Church in Monticello in the heart of Southeast Arkansas. A wonderful place to be a part of that so many people call their spiritual home. I want you to do me a favor this morning, if you would, as you are worshiping from home, light a candle to signify the light of Christ that has broken into your life. And maybe find something beautiful, such as a plant or a flower, or maybe a picture to signify the beauty of God's creation. Create a worship space around you so that God can adequately break in and speak to you this morning. We are so thankful for this day. We are thankful for you. And my prayer is that God would bless you, not only throughout this worship service, but throughout all the days of your life. I'd like to also ask you, if you would, to please check in with us. We would love to know who you are and where you are and where you're worshiping. Like our Facebook page and check us out on Instagram and Twitter. We would love to get to know you and for you to get to know us just a little bit better. And now our associate pastor, Reverend Lori Fallon, will come and she will share prayer concerns and also lead us in our opening prayer.
Good morning. As we move into this time of prayer, I want to first of all invite you to add your own prayer concerns or celebrations to the comment section of this video. Our prayer team continues to get together every week, and we pray over every name that is given to us. We welcome you to email us anytime at prayer@fumcmonticello.org. Let us know how we can pray for you or with you or celebrate for you or with you. We celebrate that next Sunday, March the 7th, we are relaunching our in-person worship. You will have the opportunity to come and worship with us at 9 a.m. in the Family Life Center and at 11 a.m. in the sanctuary. Look for your emails this coming week, as well as text messages and in the newsletter for more information about how to let us know that you're coming so that we will have space and chairs for you and your family. We continue to pray for those of you that are fighting illness, fighting disease, those of you that are in quarantine or fighting COVID-19. We're praying for you if you're having tests this week or you have surgery before you. For those of you that are mourning, we are praying for you. Wherever you are in life, I want you to know that you are not alone. God is with you. We want to share your burdens. And now I'd like to offer a prayer for us. And I want to encourage you to open your hands. Let the words of the call to prayer, let the words of the prayer resonate with you. Let these words be heard on your heart as we say them together. Let us pray.
Come home.
Our loving God, there is so much darkness in our lives. We find ourselves hiding from you. Take our hands. Lead us out of the shadows of fear. Take our burdens and show us the light. Help us to change our hearts. We want to be more like Jesus. We long for your presence, God. Fill us with your truth. Help us to respond to your generous love and to accept your amazing grace. We know that we are not worthy. Forgive us for doubting you and your light. We need you, God. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Open our eyes to hear your words. Open our ears to hear. And now let the confidence of children of God be with us this day as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Are you ready for a miracle?
Ready as I can be.
Are you ready for a miracle?
Spirit will set you free.
Are you ready?
Are
you ready? Are you ready?
You to give your financial gifts to the ministries of First United Methodist Church of Monticello. You can give in a variety of ways. You're welcome to mail a check to the office, 317 South Main Street, Monticello, Arkansas, 71655. You may give online through our website, FUMCMonticello.org, look for the Give tab, or you may use your smart device or your smart tablet and use the Give Plus app. We are all blessed to be in ministry together. Won't you partner with us and give of your financial gifts to the ministries so that we might make disciples for the transformation of the world by being in mission together. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls. How have you been? Today, our Bible story is from the book of Mark, chapter 4. Jesus tells a story about a farmer that throws out seeds. He sows the seeds, and about the soil where the seeds land. He explains to the disciples later that he is the farmer. The stories that Jesus throws to the people is like the seeds that the farmer throws to the soil. And the soil where the seeds land is like the people's hearts that receive God's word. The first seeds land on hard soil. No matter how good the seeds, if the soil is hard, the seeds die. They cannot grow. Jesus' stories of God's love sometimes fall on people with hard hearts, angry hearts. And the good stories of God's love die in their hearts. The second seeds fall on soil with rocks. At first, the seeds start to grow, but because of the rocks, there can be no roots and the plants die. When people who hear God's words of love are excited at first, but yet they don't study God's words and they don't pray, then those words eventually die in their hearts as well. The third seeds fall on soil that's full of bad weeds. Well, sometimes when people hear God's words, they have bad habits that choke out the words of God's love, and the words die in their hearts, just like the bad weeds would choke out the seeds that fall there. The last set of seeds, those seeds fall on good soil, soil that is ready for the seeds. It rains, the sun shines, and the seeds grow to their fullest. When people hear the words of God's love and their hearts are ready to receive God's words of love, those stories grow in their hearts. In fact, they grow so much that others see God's love through those people. That's who we want to be like. In fact, that is who you are like. You show God's love with your words and with your actions. We delivered packets with Season of Lent activities and Bible verses for you. One of the packets had a set of seeds. When you plant these seeds, your seeds, in soil that is ready for your seeds and you water it and the sun shines, think of those that receive God's words in their heart. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these precious children. Thank you that their hearts are ready for your word, that your word will grow in them to its fullest, and that others will see your good works through them and want to be more like you as well. Forgive us for our sins. Watch over us this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Share with you this morning a portion of scripture that comes out of the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Mark. beginning with the first verse. Let us now hear these words that have been written and recorded for us. Jesus began to teach beside the lake again. Such a large crowd gathered that he climbed into a boat there on the lake. He sat in the boat while the whole crowd was nearby on the shore. He said many things to them in parables. While teaching them, he said, "Listen to this. A farmer went out to scatter seed. As he was scattering seed, some fell on the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Other seed fell on rocky ground where the soil was shallow. They sprouted immediately because the soil wasn't deep. When the sun came up, it scorched the plants, and they dried up because they had no roots. Other seed fell among thorny plants. The thorny plants grew and choked the seeds, and they produced nothing. Other seed fell into good soil and bore fruit. Upon growing and increasing, the seed produced in one case a yield of 30 to 1, in another case a yield of 60 to 1, and in another case a yield of 100 to 1. He said, "Whoever has ears to listen should pay attention." My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I want to ask you a question. Are you giving up anything for Lent? Well, maybe I should ask you this question. Do you have any idea what Lent is? In the Christian church, Lent is the preparation time before Easter. It is a time for us to reflect, to pray, to read Scripture, to make sure that our hearts and our lives are ready for that grand celebration of Easter. And in the course of the Christian year, Lent is a time for us to be thinking more attentively about our relationship with God and how we are growing to become more like God. And people sometimes, during the season of Lent, give up things. Now, they don't give them up for just no reason whatsoever. They give them up so that they can have more time to spend devoted to growing in that relationship to God. Let me give you an example. Maybe you have a favorite television show. It happens on Monday night at 7 o'clock. Well, during the 7 weeks of Lent, every Monday night, instead of watching that television show, you would spend that time reading the Bible, or maybe praying, or reflecting, or reading some other devotional material. Some other folks give up other things, such as chocolate, or God forbid, caffeine, during the season of Lent. So let me ask you this again. Are you giving up anything for Lent? Now, here's another question. Does anybody know it? Now, I ask that question because invariably, back in the day when we could freely go places before COVID, when we could go unmasked and we could go on retreats and we could go on vacations and we could go to meetings, you would always run into someone who always wanted to let you know upon first meeting them that they were giving up something for Lent. And it's almost like it was a badge of honor that they were giving this up, and they were trying to make sure that everyone knew this. And it was funny that a lot of times if there was a meeting or an event that had food involved, that is when it was touted the most. I'm giving up something for Lent. Oh, I can't have dessert because I'm giving that up for Lent. Or I can't have that cup of coffee because I'm giving that up for Lent. You know, and that reminds me of a scripture coming out of the Gospel of Matthew, the 6th chapter. I want to share that with you. And this is a pretty interesting portion of scripture. Here's what Jesus says. "And when you fast," which is really what we are doing in Lent when we are giving up something, "don't put on a sad face like the hypocrites. They distort their faces so people will know they are fasting. I assure you that they have their reward. When you fast, brush your hair and wash your face. Then you won't look like you are fasting to people, but only to your Father who is present in that secret place. Your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Now, I read that portion of Scripture and I ask you these questions today because our other Scripture reading that was read just a few moments ago out of the Gospel of Mark, which has to do with a farmer sowing a seed. Oftentimes when we read that, our usual go-to is to focus in on the cultivation of the soil, the work that is done. You know, it talks about the seed falling on rocky ground and fallow ground and good ground. And we want to go to the place where we think that cultivation or the work, if you say that, is what really matters. And while soil cultivation is a significant part of growth, we need to tend to the ground, especially when we are planting a garden or planting a field. You know, farmers and gardeners spend a lot of time on soil development. And that's where we tend to go in that portion of Scripture. And soil cultivation does create good soil. However, we often assume after reading this parable that the takeaway should be that our primary job as Christians is to cultivate good soil in our lives and in the lives of those around us. And this interpretation can often lead us to trying to work harder and put more effort into being better Christians. It almost lends itself into a works view of faith. I've got to work. I've got to do. I've got to put the time in. And when we focus on our own effort, we may incorrectly conclude that if God seems silent, and oftentimes God does seem silent, in the midst of our listening to God, it's oftentimes we can't hear God. Maybe there's a problem going on, or there's a circumstance that is clouding our ability. And in those silent moments, we can be tempted to believe that the reason why we're not hearing God is because we're not working hard enough. We're not praying hard enough. We're not believing strongly enough. There's something wrong with us that God is not speaking, and we must work harder. And since many of us, all of us, exist in a culture that values and rewards productivity, it's easy to transfer this to our faith. Because the adage, you know, you work hard enough, you're going to gain, and if you don't gain, it's because you didn't work hard enough. And we translate that over to our faith and we start believing wrong things and we start getting ourselves into that trap that I'm not good enough, that I haven't worked hard enough, that God doesn't see what I have done is honorable enough to answer me. And always working, always striving for more, sometimes communicates to ourselves and to others when we live out that working type of faith that God is not trustworthy enough to care for us and that we must try harder. We have to do something to get God's attention. So the question is, do we trust God to do the work in us? Even if we aren't striving to force that work to happen. When we try to work harder to earn love, to earn grace, we will always be left wanting. We'll always be left wanting. Because grace, my friends, is a gift. It is a gift. It is not a reward for good behavior. Just because you've been good enough doesn't mean that God's going to give you more grace than someone else. Love and grace is given freely to us because we are the beloved of God. God is the one who loves first, always, and He loves us lavishly. And focusing upon our own effort can and often does lead to what the church calls legalism. And that's the belief that we are honoring God if we do the right things in the right way. So if cultivation, if we are not the key player, if Jesus is not saying in the parable that we read in Mark that the cultivator is the hero of the story, who's the key player? Who's the hero in this story? It's the farmer. It's the farmer. Because the farmer comes along and is generous and gracious in the way he sows the seeds. Now, there's one thing you need to know about farming in the Bible. A farmer would come along and would cast the seed. And that was their job. They cast the seed. And there were others that came along and began to do the work of tilling the soil and making sure that the seeds got into good places. But oftentimes the farmer would just reach in a bag and just throw the seed indiscriminately, not really caring where it landed. And Jesus is saying that that is the generous nature of God. He is not seeking out specific soil, but is extravagantly scattering the seeds. Sowing so many seeds is an action of extravagance. The farmer is not afraid of a shortage. He's not afraid that he's going to run out. He doesn't measure out the seed like sometimes we measure out ingredients for a pie. He just reaches in and he grabs a handful and he throws it out to the left and to the right. And even seeds sometimes fall in places where they don't thrive. But still, the farmer is generous. And he knows that a generous crop is going to be produced at the end of the parable. And that's the way God is. God is generous. God is extravagant. God has grace that He desires to extend out into all the world. Not looking at any one particular place, but scattering it to the far reaches of the world. And the one thing that we do is that we co-labor with the Holy Spirit to do the work of the kingdom of God in the world. But it is never a work that we do on our own. We work alongside God. It's not all up to us. And that's the good news. It's not all up to us. God comes along through the power of the Holy Spirit and takes what we give. As meager as it may be, as limited as it may be at times, and produces something great. There's an old gospel song that I've heard from time to time that says, little is much when God is in it. And that's the truth. Little is much as God is in it. And we often think, I have nothing to offer. Well, offer it anyway. And you will see that God does major things with it. The Holy Spirit is always the key player, the initiator, and the sustainer of the work. So we don't need to strive more to earn God's love or grace. We need to trust, even in small seed-like ways, that the Holy Spirit is at work in our lives and in our world. We can celebrate the growth that is taking place in our lives because we know that God is faithful. God is not faithful because we are trying harder or doing more. God is faithful because that's just who God is. God is faithful because God's faithfulness is God's very nature. And we can celebrate and trust that God is at work in the world, even when it appears sometimes that God is not. And we don't need to be stingy with the ways that we extend grace and love toward others. We need to look at the generousness of God. The farmer was extravagant in the way that he sowed the seeds. So we should follow that example and do the same. And be generous in the way that we share our love with the world. And the way that we share our love with God. God was generous with us. May we be generous with others. And may we be generous with what God has given us in giving it back to Him. So that He can do some amazing things with it. You know, we often focus so much in this season on what we are doing in order to grow in our relationship that sometimes we forget that the most important person in this relationship isn't us. It's Christ. We forget that the greatest work being done in through the grace is being done through the grace of the Holy Spirit. The greatest growth is happening when we submit to whatever God may have for us versus striving to cause the growth to happen. We learn from this story that God is in the work, extravagantly bestowing grace upon all of us, upon you and upon me and upon everyone in the world. And we learn there is enough for all of us. And we can trust that life is growing and will continue to grow if we have eyes to see and the trust to rest and celebrate the work that is happening. So trust in God. God is doing a work in you. God is doing a work in me. And to that, I say, thanks be to God. Let's pray. O eternal God, we give you thanks for all that you are doing in our lives. Help us to rest secure in that, realizing that it isn't about working ourselves to the bone or trying harder, but it is about resting secure in your arms of grace and mercy, knowing that you will send us out to work and to do, but you don't send us out to work and to do to earn favor. You send us out to work and to do so that we can share your love with the world. We thank you for this season of Lent. We thank you for the lessons that we are learning through this season that makes us who we are, that helps us and enables us to grow into the people that you are calling us to be. We give you thanks for what you were doing and the ways in which you were doing it. And we offer this prayer up to you in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen and amen. chosen to join us today for this worship experience. I trust that God has spoken to you today. I know that God has spoken to you today. And maybe this is a time for you to think seriously about your commitments, since this is the season of Lent. Maybe your commitment is to profess faith in Christ and to join a church and be baptized for the very first time. Maybe your commitment is actually a recommitment. Maybe you haven't been in church for some time, but you feel that nudge of God to get re-involved, to rededicate your life, to begin anew, a life of study, witness, and prayer. Whatever your decision is, whatever God is nudging you to do today, I hope that you will reach out to me at the email address listed below. I would love to pray with you. I would love to have a conversation with you about any of these matters. And I want to thank everyone who had a part in this worship service today. God was both blessed and honored by everything that was happening here today. And so now, my friends, I pray that you will receive this blessing as this service comes to a close. Knowing that worship never ceases, we just go out into the world to spread the love of Jesus and what we have encountered in worship to others. So receive this blessing. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the faith that has sustained us all these years, the blessings of the Holy Spirit, empower us, equip us, and help us to live our lives with authenticity and grace. Go forth in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.